Unfolding the eternal excellences, the hidden insights of the truth, and the depth of the riches of wisdom and knowledge.
The Bible says, I have cleansed thee by the word. I have not pointed to your weaknesses. He says, I have cleansed thee by the word. I have pointed to your strength. And this is your strength, that I am Christ in you, the hope of glory.
The glory of freedom, the glimpses into eternity.
The gospel is not supposed to be an assumption. It's not supposed to be just a mere presupposition. Truth is older than language, but the word of God is way deeper than any human language.
And now, Apostle Grace with the Word.
Every crowd. There's something about the presence. In the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth. The Bible says that the earth was without void, without form and void, and darkness was upon the face of the deep. And the Bible says that the Spirit of God moved upon the face of the waters. And God said, somebody say God said. Say it again. Tell that woman. The Bible says, God said, let there be, and the Bible says there were lights. And God saw the light, and that it was good. And God divided the light from darkness. And God called the light day, and darkness he called. And the Bible says, and the evening and the morning were the first day. Hallelujah. The Lord was speaking to me about the mind and the spirit behind creation. The Bible says in Hebrews that by faith we understand. Somebody say we understand. The Bible says that through faith we understand that the worlds were framed by the word of God. And the Bible says that the things which are seen are not made of things which do appear. The word there, do appear, is present continuous. Meaning there are things that appeared last year, there are things that are appearing now, there are things that are going to appear tomorrow, There are things that are going to appear next year. Hallelujah. Now, we carry a position in God that has active participation in the appearance of things. That's called the responsibility of revelation. When God reveals himself to you, it means he says that you carry a responsibility to reveal things. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. There are people here who say, I don't know what God is going to bring tomorrow. I don't know what God is going to bring next week. I don't know, whatever will be. People say, I don't know what's going to happen next year. And that's understandable to your degree of interpretation. But that's not the call of the child of God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. That's not the call of the child of God. I usually tell people that this is eternal life. That we might know the one true God and his only son, Jesus Christ, whom he has sent. Many times I repeat that sentence, that scripture, John 17:3, because I realize that every time I look into it, it comes with a vastness of revelation. And every time I read it, it blows me. Let me give you an example. The Bible says, it's not unto the angels that he subjected the world to come. Are you with me? He says, for unto the angels has he not put in subjection the world to come, whereof we speak. In other words, when God looked at the next 20 years or 30 years, he didn't put them in the hands of angels. He put them in the hands of you and I. And the Bible says, I don't know if you understand what I'm saying. The Bible says, he then put the next worlds, the next years to come, subject to angels. That means he placed the worlds to come, but he also put them subject to certain people, to certain things. Meaning that the next 10 years can be subject to you. Or you can be subject to the next 10 years. Or you can survive in the next 10 years. The next 20 years can be subject to you. Or you can be subject to them, or you can survive in them. God has not called me, I don't know about you, you can also say, to be a survivor. He has called me to enter a world that is subject to me. Meaning that I must have and prepare my spirit to understand that the next coming years, I'm not only going to be ready for them, they're going to be under me. In the name of Jesus. I shall be the head and not the tail. I decree and declare that you shall be the head and not the tail. That in the coming years, you shall be above and not beneath. I decree and declare that 2017 is subject to you. 2018 is subject to you. 2019 is subject to you. 2020 is subject to you. 2030 is subject to you. When I realize that, I understood that you can determine to touch the world until the world comes to an end. Listen, there are songs you can sing, and they may never be sung the next 20 years. But there are songs that have come from the Moravian revivals, the 18 somethings, the 17 somethings. And every time you sing them, they come with a certain life to them. Why? Because some of these men saw something eternal. When you glimpse through eternity and cause it to be your source of inspiration, you realize that whatever appears on earth through you will exist, survive, and minister till the end of the world. Somebody say amen. I have made up my mind to know that until the end of the world, my sermons will be played. I don't know by who, but I'm certain by multitudes. That's me. That's my faith. You can choose to say yes, you can choose to say no. The Bible says, be done unto you according to your faith. So, next year is subject to you. The next 10 years are under you. But you can choose to say, I don't know what's coming. Really, you don't see that. Hallelujah. Now, when you understand where I'm coming from, in a few minutes, you will realize that for so long, we've not known the truth. Because you see, under all circumstances, the Bible says you know the truth. And the truth, the Bible says, not say, make you free. It is the primary responsibility of truth to make your life free. You're not supposed to make yourself free. You're supposed to receive truth, and truth makes you free. Somebody say amen. Somebody say amen. God give me utterance. God just give me utterance. So you look at the beginning of creation. I want to show you. So when the Bible says in Hebrews that we understand that the worlds are framed by the word of God, and that things which are seen are not made of things which do appear. It means that the things which do appear are made of things which you don't see. Do you understand? And therefore, procreation as a grace on every believer means that we carry the anointing and grace to create things. Do you understand? That is according to the ministration of the word of truth in our souls or our spirits. Let me give you an example. Let me show you a scripture. 1 John chapter 5, verses 20. 1 John chapter 5, verses 20. The Bible says, and we know. Somebody say we know. We don't pray, we know. Somebody say we know. We don't hope. Somebody say we know. We don't just believe. Somebody say we know. The Bible says we know that the Son of God is come, and He has given us an understanding. The Son of God has come, the Bible says, and He has given us an understanding. He has given you a house. That's okay. He has given you a job, because the Bible says you've been blessed with every spiritual blessing in heaven place in Christ Jesus. He has given you everything that pertains to life and godliness. But above all, I want us to first borrow the mind of John here. He says, and we know, somebody say we know, that the Son of God is come, comma, and has given us an understanding, comma, that we may know Him that is true. Are you hearing me? He has come and has given us an understanding that we may know Him, the Bible says, that is true, and, comma, we are in Him, that is, He didn't say, and that we are in Him. No. He's not given the knowledge to know that you're in God. He's not given of the knowledge that you're in God. The Bible says that we may know Him that is what? Truth. And we are in Him that is true, even in His Son Jesus Christ. And the Bible says that is the what? The true God and eternal life. Now let me explain that dispensation of eternal life. When the Bible says the Son of God has given us an understanding, the Greek word there is dianoia. And I'm going to explain it. Dianoia. D-I-A-N-O-I-A. Dianoia. The Son of God is come and He has given us dianoia. Okay? And this is what dianoia means. Dianoia is a mind that is of the Spirit to know how to think in a certain way and feel in a certain way. I don't know if you understand what I'm saying. The Son of God is come to make us think a certain way and feel a certain way by the Spirit. Oh, that if I have a certain mind in God, I have to, that mind is to think a certain way and to feel a certain way. So, when the Son of God came, He realized to know Him, I have to first make them think a certain way. Not just to think, but a certain way. Not just to feel, but a certain way. There is a way in the feeling. There is a way in the thinking. We were not called to think in the gospel only, we were called to think a certain way in the gospel. We were not called to feel in the gospel only. We were called to feel in a certain way in the gospel. And the next line says, that we may know him. That is true. That is, if you want to know the one true God, he has to first position you in a certain thinking way. The reason why people say, ah, but I've tried, but I don't know God, I read the Bible, I don't understand, it's because you think a certain way. The mind of God is in a certain way. I'll give you an example. Let me do something I've ever done before. Somebody with a stomach echoes headache, come. Yes, I want to show you something. Anybody, if you're feeling any pain, come. Come. What are you feeling, headache or stomach? Stomach. How long has it been? 2 days. Okay. Now, I want you to close your eyes. Okay? Now, I want you to observe this, okay? Don't worry, I'm not experimenting something new. I've done it before. I want you to observe this, okay? You see, I've not laid a hand on him. You understand? I've not laid a hand on him. Somebody might think that to get disease out of a man, I need to lay a hand. That's your thinking. It's not the way of the Spirit. Do you understand? Somebody might think that to get disease out of a man, I must say something. Because the Bible says, you will say. Somebody was praying and say, how do we pray? When you pray, say. So, if you don't say, you don't pray. But it's because that's his understanding of saying. I don't know if you understand what I'm saying. Brother, get up. Let him get up. Are you feeling any pain?
It has gone.
Totally. You may be seated. Totally. You see, now, I said something, but none of you heard me. But you can assume that I didn't say nothing. Because your interpretation of saying is seeing my physical lips moving and the voice coming out of me. Do you understand? Do you understand what I'm saying? And that is why sometimes, sadly, the church becomes religious than revelational. Because we have learned a certain pattern of things, and we think that those things in their own sense define our relationship with God. Do you understand? Do you understand what I'm saying? Dianoia means that God wants to switch your way of thinking to the way he thinks, and your way of feeling to the way he feels. It is a mind in the spirit, the number three, the mind, that is a spirit. The mind of the spirit, having a way of thinking and feeling. It has a way it thinks. You have a way you feel. If you don't think the right way or feel the right way, you cannot know God. That is why in Acts 17:26 it says, he has made of one blood all nations. The Bible says that they should dwell on all the face of the earth and have determined the times before appointed and the bounds of their habitation. Not physical only, but spiritual habitations too. God has given us spiritual places where we exercise spiritual influence. Some people think that's just the physical boundaries that you live in Uganda. No. You're past Uganda. The influence on you goes beyond Uganda. Somebody say amen. The Bible says that his name was voiced abroad. Voice. You see? So, when the Bible says he has made one blood all nations of all men to dwell on all the face of the earth, and has determined the times, that is your timing in the spirit, and the bounds of their habitation. And the Bible says that they should seek the Lord. You see, they're seeking. If happy, the Bible says, they might feel after him. Then what? Find him. If you don't feel after God, you cannot find him. That doesn't mean I seek God, I fast and pray. Yes. But you must feel a certain way after him. When you feel after, you'll find him. You will find him. So, it's important for a man to have a certain state of feeling and thinking a certain way. Let me give you an example. Let me probably qualify. Why do you think I began from Genesis? I'll explain why I began from Genesis. There are two things that seem alike, but they are not. And I pray you follow me very well. There's a difference between the power of his word and the word of his power. Are you hearing me? They all seem like they're the same, but they're different. What if I say something with my lips and then it comes to pass? That's the power of my word. You understand? But I can say something. The power upon me can say something without me saying. And then it gets into a man's stomach and heals it. So you say, but it says nothing. Yes, that is the difference between the power of my words and the words of my power. When I was beginning and started to speak and the power of God started to move, that is the word, that's the power of my words. When I ministered healing to him, that is the word of the power. I don't know if you understood what I'm saying. Hebrews chapter 1, verses 3. Let's read. The Bible says, and being the brightness of his glory and the express image of his person, the Bible says, he upholds all things by the word of his power. He upholds, he keeps everything in control by the word of his power. He doesn't keep everything in control only by the power of his word. Some people think God, Jesus controls the earth by confessing every time. Now they'll not fall, they'll stand. No. The Bible says he upholds all things by the rhema of his dunamis. For example, I have a conscience that I don't get sick. I don't need to confess it. That's the rhema of the dunamis in me. Every morning it is fresh. I'm not conscious of it. I don't need to say it every day. But if I say it, it will come with the power. But even if I don't say it, the power has it. I don't know if you understand what I'm saying. Even if I don't say it, the power in me has that word. For the Bible says the word is nigh thee. It is that word in your mouth, the word which you speak. I don't need to say certain things to cause change. Because I know another way to say without saying. And it is in the power which is in me. Now to him which is able to do exceedingly, abundantly, above. Listen, now read that scripture very well. Read the Amplified. Now listen, he says, he by in consequence of the action of his power that is at work within us, I see, is able to carry out, this is things happening without you saying anything. He's able to carry out his purpose and do, the Bible says, superabundantly, far over, above all that we dare to ask or think, infinitely, beyond our highest prayer. Oh, my God, even when you say I can pray, there's a place where
That's why I worry about you. Because how can you continue hearing these things and say no more? How? Listen. Prayer, if you're talking of prayer speech, you can pray and speak and get tired of speaking. And still the dunamis in you has a certain rhema. See, that is why when he's defining the kingdom of God in the dispensation of truth, he says it's like yeast. Yeast doesn't need to say anything. Yeast does not need to say anything. That is why I'm cautious that all my neighbors are healthy because of me. It's not a prayer. I don't pray for the health of my neighborhood. No. No. I'm cautious in my spirit. When the Bible says he will never let his righteous see corruption. See corruption. Do you understand? It means I'll never see you having an accident with my eyes. That's corruption. I will never see you fail. I will not. I don't anticipate it. See, that's the way. That's the way I think. I don't anticipate that you will fail. In my head, I don't pray that you don't fail. It's not a confession before God to tell him, God, I pray you'll make them stand. Neither. No, not at all. In my head, I'm fully conscious of my spirit that you cannot fail. If you fail, it is because you opposed yourself. The Spirit of God refuses us to strive. And I've seen it many times in the mind of religious Christians. The Bible says that the servant of God must not, even in prayer, you must not strive. Even in ministry, you must not strive. Even in business, you must not, oh, now we thrive, we did it 20 years, that is why I've lived. No. You're not supposed to strive. Tell your neighbor, you're not supposed to strive. Things are supposed to come easy. Say it again. Somebody will say, in this world, you have to strive and work harder and work harder. What did Jesus do? Okay, if you want to do it harder, do it harder. For us, we choose the easy way. Let me tell you, the moment a man starts to complicate the gospel, he's corrupting. That's why the Bible says that they've been corrupted from the simplicity which is in Christ. The gospel is supposed to be simple. But the corruption there, and he says, by fear least by any means, 1 Corinthians 1:11-3. He says, by fear least by any means, as the serpent beguiled it through his subtlety, so your mind should be corrupted from the simplicity which is in Christ. It doesn't mean that he's not deep. He's just deeply simple. Or simply deep. God is bottomless. But in everything we access in him, there ought to be a simplicity. And I pray upon your life, I don't know why I feel convicted to say this, that things will happen easy, quicker, and simple for you. I say it again, that things will happen quickly, simply, and easy for you. In Jesus' mighty name. That you will not struggle. That you will not struggle. That you will not struggle. Say that the servant of God might not strive. But the Bible says, but be gentle unto all men, apt to teach. Patience. In meekness, the Bible says, instructing those that oppose themselves. If God peradventure will give them repentance to the acknowledging, the epignosis of the truth, and that they may recover themselves out of the snare of the devil, and that last line cut me so deep. He said, who are taken captive by him at his will? There are people in this world, the devil now can wake up and say, I'm going to kill you. And they're dead. They're living by the devil's mercy. Now, if the devil even has mercy. No, seriously. Captive at his own will. Like he can decide and say, on Tuesday night I'm coming, and there is nothing in the world you can do. Nothing whatsoever. Yes, nothing. There are people like that. The devil right now can make something in his life and mess him up tonight. the devil says, I'm coming at 9. He will, 3 a.m. He will come at 3 a.m. and mess that person up. And there is nothing that person can do. Nothing. Even if he says, I'm not going to fail, I'll fail. Even if they confess, in the name of Jesus, I decree and declare, I'll get married, they'll grow older. In the name of Jesus, I decree, I'm going to get business, the business fails. In the name of Jesus, my ministry just fails. Why? Because they are under a certain captivity at the will of the devil. That's not supposed to be the life of a child of God. When you decree a thing, it must be established. That was a promise from God. Somebody say amen. Somebody say amen. So, there is a conscience in me that cannot think corruption. Somebody come and tell me, there's a church member, they are worse, they are doing this and that. I told them, don't worry. If they're our church member, they'll be fine. They'll be fine. But Apostle, why do you say that? You see, I cannot explain to you why I'm saying it. But they'll be okay. They'll be okay. I'm sure they will be okay. Do you understand? Even if I didn't say it, they'll still be okay. Because it's inside their power, that anointing inside my spirit and yours. So when he says, for example, that this goes beyond your wildest prayers, your dreams, infinitely beyond your highest prayers, desires, thoughts, hopes, and dreams, and it's inside your spirit, and it's working. There is a workable experience producing substance physically, but it's not subject to what you even say. It's entirely subject to the anointing in you, because the anointing in you can release certain rema without you saying. I don't know that you understand what I'm saying. What is inside you can say without you saying. So that is the essence of yeast. He says that the kingdom of God is likened unto yeast. He said, which a woman took, hidden 3 measures in the milk, till the whole lamp was leavened. The whole meal was leavened. The whole of it. In other words, for me to cause change, I don't need to say. I just need to think a certain way. And I just need to feel a certain way. I think a certain way, I feel a certain way, according to the mind and the spirit of truth, and I cause change around me. That is why I'm cautious. People who live around me don't fall sick. And that's me. It's my conscience. People around me don't fall sick. I just think things. People around me can't fail, even if they try. It's not pride. Somebody says, this proud guy, because he didn't begin the sermon. I'm cautious. I'm set to think a certain way. That's the setting in my configuration. Do you understand what I'm saying? Listen. When you understand that, you will enter a company and it starts making profit. I tested it when I was banking. I would just enter. I said, I saw God doing things. I saw God doing things. There was a time as a branch manager, and when the business just chose to come, I didn't. And that's why I had to quit, because it was unfair. Guys were going in the market to look for business. For me, business was in the market looking for me. It was so unfair. And I performed. And after performing well, I quit. I don't know if you understand what I'm saying. Because some of you are resorting to hard work, and it has its place. But only if grace is laboring in you. Then, if you lose the place of grace, it doesn't matter how long you work, you will be found and overtaken. And that is the truth. That is the truth. That is the truth. See, I have to think in my head that I'm deep. Before somebody tells me, Apostle Chris, you're deep, I must think it. I have to think a certain way. Because you see, without faith, it's impossible to please God. God loves watching people when he's happy. If you want to keep God happy, you must set your mind a certain way. Deliberately. I don't know who I'm speaking to. So, before you define me, I define myself. It doesn't mean I don't go through stuff. I do. But even in the middle of that stuff, I still tell myself, I'm bigger than this. I'm bigger than this. I am bigger than this. I am bigger than this. I am bigger than this. Why? Because greater is he which is in me than the devil in the world. He that began a good work in me shall see to accomplish with the day of Christ. For he is able to keep that which I have committed unto me till the day of Christ. When I committed to him my life, I am certain that he keeps me. That's why when Peter is talking about the brethren, he speaks of them which are kept by the power of God. I'm kept by the power of God. I'm kept by the power of God. Through what? Through what? Through what? Through faith and to salvation. Because that pattern of believing is what saves you. If you think you're going to fail, you will fail. I promise you, darling. If you think that this is not working, it will not work. If you think your wife is funny, she'll stay funny. If your husband is funny, he will be. Because that's the way you've set your life to be. Hallelujah. So that's why the Bible says, when it comes to upholding things, because God needs a constant life of things in the right order. You understand? When you need to have a constant line of things in the right order, you need to use the word of the power. The rhema of the power. Go back to Genesis. He says in the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth. I want to show you something very, very wonderful. And he says, and the earth was without form and void, and darkness was upon the face of the deep, and the Spirit of the Lord moved upon the face of the waters. And the third verse says, and God said, let there be light, and there was light. Now, one time the Spirit of the Lord led me to study that scripture, and here is what amazed me. If God said, let there be, and life wasn't, who was he speaking to? Come on. He says, let there be. That means there is nothing. So, light is not responding to his instruction. Because it's not there. So, when he says, let there be light, and there was light, you understand? You're going to be shocked. When I read the Hebrew, original, before even the translation, the Septuagint, it read like, let there be light, and there was light, were the same thing. They were the same statements. That means that the command also came with the affirmation and confirmation and fulfillment. So to God, let there be and there was are the same things. But when he says let there be, there must be. But Matthew, he wasn't speaking to anyone to respond to create. He wasn't instructing anyone. Because there was no entity present to respond to that voice and execute his mind. So when I went into it, I realized that the Hebrew statement there is, it is light. You understand? It went into the substance of the faculty of God's thinking. And by the time he thought it, it already became. Now, the translator says, he says, meaning that the third pattern of God carries both the ability, the willingness of his mind to create something. It sets forth every material and skill necessary to execute and create. Therefore, according to the right rendering, it should be, it is light. If you don't get it, look at me. Imagine this is God. Then he says, light. It's up to light. It's up to light to say, this is what he means. It's not up to. And light cannot say, I've refused. Because he has defined it. It is light. The process of God thinking it starts to create. And then he saw. And it was good. You know, the scriptures can confuse when you don't understand the mind. Because I know many, some of you have read 33, Psalms 33, 9. When I say, he spoke the world, created the world by his word, by his mouth, for he spake and it was done and he commanded and it stood. You see, if you read it from that perspective, you might think that it was a physical voice that created the earth. No. The mind of God is simple. He just starts to think something and then it starts to make itself. You understand? That is why you have a problem with double-minded people. Because they frustrate the design of creation. You just frustrate the design of creation, the pattern of creation. Says, let there. It is. When he got to man, he said, wait a minute. It is not mine. He went deeper. He said, it is not mine. He says, let us, Elohim, Father, Son, and the Holy Ghost, create a certain guy who is like us. Is it saying? And it's saying carries the power to start creating. You remember in Genesis 11 when we were talking about the people who were building the Tower of Babel? Now let's read verse 1. The whole earth was of one language and of one speech. You can have the same language but different speech. You can have the same speech but different language. He's talking about the same language and the same speech. You understand? And then he goes down and he says, it came to pass as they journeyed from the east, they found a plain in the land of Shinar and they dwelt there. And they said to themselves, let us make brick, burn them thoroughly. And they hacked a brick for stone and slime and they for mortar. And they said, God, let us build us a city and a tower whose top may reach unto the heavens. They were like him. So the moment they say we are building something that goes to heaven, they've already built it. Before they even put their hand to the plow, they've already built it. That is why it says, these people, in the lesser verses, the last verses, and the Lord says, behold, these people is what? Now read the language, read the language. And they have all one language. And this they begin to do. And he says, and now nothing will be restrained to them which they have imagined. Imagine, Fanero. He says, nothing. Okay. Imagine what? mean, that's what I'm imagining now. You can imagine something. Come on, help me. He says, nothing they imagined is restrained. Now, the word there for restrained, let me get for you from the Greek. I've not planned to go there. Genesis 11, 6, right? Let me read for you the Hebrew for the word restrained. Ayeba. Somebody say mantakaya. Genesis 11, verses 6. Listen. Restrained. First off, 45, inaccessible. Nothing they imagine will be inaccessible. So access is here. He says nothing will be 45 or cut off or made inaccessible. But and the third definition is whether it's secrets, mischief, things substantive. Nothing can be withheld from them. The moment they imagine, they've started creation. Because they are like him. They are like him. They are like him. They're like him. The moment you start to think a certain way, you become it. Without even prayer and fasting. If you feel you're not beautiful, nobody is going to make you beautiful. I swear. Better encourage yourself. In the Lord. Redeem the time. Because by the time you get it, you might be 50. So by the time the guy comes and says, man, you're beautiful, tell me, I made it happen. I made it happen. That's me. Back in those days, I used to have groups of friends. They used to call themselves millionaires. They used to put on very tight, skinny suits. And then they walk when their legs are a bit crossed like this. They say, we're millionaires. And I never used to put on suits. I looked over the yard and I realized these guys are not millionaires. Some of them are not. It's because even if they convince themselves, your ministry can fail if you think the wrong thoughts. Your marriage can fail if you think the wrong thoughts. It's not in the power of him to change your heart. It's in the power of you to think the right thoughts. If you want to see God, your business can sink. It's not in the power of that business to stand or in the power of the economy to sustain it. It's in the thought here. What you don't call here, what you don't kill here can't die. You remember the Shunammite woman? The child is dead. Elijah sends the servant and tells him, go check out. Is it well with thee? Is it well with your son and your husband? And the lady says, yes, it is well. But the kid is dead. The kid is dead. She says, blah, 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 blah. Don't they tell me, oh, mama. Rosie did they? They don't they do it. I'm told these days they pay some people to do it. Is somebody around so we can refer you? They all know, they're professional mourners. They know how to mourn. I think it's an art. Because I've seen somebody like that one day. I went for burial. And this person was like, Yes, what was the name? They're too overwhelmed to say. Wow! I had a feeling she didn't know who. It's my fault. God forgive me, friend. I'm not accurate. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Now, I want to finish this. God tells you that you can access anything. You can access anything. But you have to learn to think a certain way. What about feeling a certain way? Let's talk about feeling. Now, let's even first talk about physical feeling. Somebody wakes up and then they feel headache. And the Bible says that none among them shall say, I am sick. You understand? So how can I say I'm sick and I'm not sick when I'm feeling pain, except if I have to force myself to feel a certain way? Then you walk out with pain in your head, but feeling fresh. You will not understand me. You're understanding, don't worry. When you feel headache, you have to start feeling okay. It pounds, pow, you say, that's it, it's working. It's working. It's working. Remember the time when I used to have a funny sickness? And every time I feel pain, I would grab my hand and say, man, pain to me. I'm built. I said, I'm not saying it to become it. No. I have to force myself to feel a certain way. The body will follow later. Because if I mess up that part and I live after the flesh, he says, if you live after the flesh, listen to the word. He says, you will surely. It's not a hope. So there's a version that says surely. I hope you can get it for me. Is it amplified? Amplified, and there's a version that says surely. It's the same version I was reading. I said surely. Yeah, thank you. For if you live according to the dictates of the flesh, he says you will. As in, God is sure. Sure, you're gonna die. Somebody just get up and says, surely you'll walk in a wheelchair. Surely, surely, it's okay for some time, but you will surely, surely, surely die. It's like, why some of you are not rich? Some of you, I didn't say all of you, majority of us are. Forgive. The Bible says if you're willing and obedient, you'll eat of the good of the land. You can be obedient and give your tithes and first fruits and offering. That's one. But the path there for willingness is the mind to start feeling rich. You feel rich. You start walking. You have the feeling. You feel. Then you find a Christian. Say, box says, I see it now. Come on, how can you say that? Shame on you. One time I found a church member and I started to pronounce righteousness on them. I said, Muganga, meaning rich man, how are you? He says, come on, what are you? Muganga, tea. I said, yeah, I now understand. The moment somebody says, hey, rich woman, say, yeah, that must be me. Cannot be anywhere else. Yes! feel rich, feel wise, feel anointed, feel established, feel increased, feel beautiful, feel handsome, feel power, feel.
Respond.
to fix. The Son of Man could have said, oh God, could have said, ah, no, it's not your time. So it's understandable. No excuse. When I turn to it, it must make me rich. I know people can say the stocks exchange market is bad, but if I invest in it, churches, people don't attend service if I start a service. It's a problem for the nation. See, you remember in Genesis when he tells the man the land shall not yield its fruit? It means it's possible for the land to yield. The Uganda just loves you, the land. You understand? Sometimes it even rains for you. You're not in the mood, you're doing your own business. And then think, I wish to get through that scripture. He spoke of the land. Let me get it if he's there. Ah, thank you. And when thou tillest ground, it shall not henceforth yield unto thee has strength. Why? Because he was a fugitive and a vagabond in the earth. That means that if you're a child of God, the earth has to yield to you has strength. The earth literally has to be in exercising force to bless you. The ground has to become stressed to feed you. Literally, it has to lose peace until a certain fruit comes out for your eating. Somebody say Uganda yields to me. Uganda yields her strength to me. Let me tell you. Even if you live in a third world and they say that's the poorest country in the world, it will heap all its wealth on you. And if you want to make it rich, it's up to you. So, I would have said, but God, it was unfair to cast the tree. Yes, it was unfair not to respond to him the right way. That was its error. It wasn't God's error. No, everything I turned to, everything I put my hands on, it must be a success. Why? Because by the time I thought it, the creative force had happened. Learn to think a certain way. I'm finished. Learn to think a certain way. Learn to think a certain way. Learn to think a certain way. Learn to feel a certain way. Oh, boy, I feel blessed. Boy, I feel anointed. I feel so full. It's not a positive statement. It's the word of his power. I feel I'll make it. I feel that I'll live long. I feel that I'm a success. I just feel. I don't know how, but I feel that I have the biggest ministry on the face of the earth. Even though you can see, there's enough space for all of us men of God. Claim your portion. I ask you. I feel that I'm favored. I just feel that on the face of this earth, there's a funeral home. It's somewhere. I ask you. It's beyond whether you decide to give or not. It is there, somewhere. I just feel that we're a model. That men will look at us and learn how to build ministry. May I feel it? You can claim it with me, and we enjoy this. Or you can hate. But that's what I feel. I feel that you guys are going so far. I don't think that you're failing. I don't think that you'll die early. I don't think that you're poor. I think that you've been given everything that pertains to life and godliness. You're enriched in all things, in utterance. You come short. That's what I think in no gifts. Even as the testimony of Christ is manifested through you. That is what I think. I think that he began a good work in you. And you shall see to accomplish it at the day of Christ. I feel that he's the author and the finisher of your faith. I feel it. I think in every day that the lines are fallen unto you in pleasant places. And you have a good heritage. Whether it is prophesied in your life or it is not prophesied in your life, I think it. And I feel it. Now I'm prophesying it.
Beyond!
world listen to you. You're bigger than the armies of this world. You're bigger than the economies of this world. You're more influential than the idols of this world. You're more inspirational than the stars of this world. For greater is he which is in you than the devil in the world. I think that you're the head and not the tail. That is my way. I feel that you're changing this world. It's only a matter of time. The ground is breaking in the name of Jesus. And it's waiting for you. Create some grounds for your manifestation. Find peace, dear child of God. Find rest, child of God. For all is well with you. For he who began a good work in you is accomplishing it to the day of Christ. For he's the author and the finisher of your faith. Go home happy. It doesn't matter what you have. Go home excited. Celebrate him. Be fully persuaded that God is the ruler of all. Listen. If you're here and you say I'm not born again, but I want to receive Jesus as my personal Lord and Savior. Come on, give me a second. Don't leave. We need to experience heaven. Open your party. Put up your hand and say, I want to be born again. Put up. The angels are starting now to prepare the food. Anybody else? Say, I need Jesus today. Say, I need Jesus today. Say, I need Jesus. Anybody else? Anybody else? God bless you. Anybody else? God bless you. I feel there is more. I feel there is more. God bless you. If you put up your hand, repeat this word after me. Say, Lord Jesus, I believe in my heart and I confess with my mouth that you died and rose again. And from today, you're both Savior and Lord of my life. Amen. If you're better in prayer, come and see this brown guy. Yeah, brown. What do you think? I'm a little brown. Nice joke. And the rest. I'm not praying for anybody unless you didn't hear when I preach. I expect your WhatsApp profiles to have God addressed to some. I expect. I think. It's my way of thinking. Bye.
The message you have just heard was brought to you by Phanero Ministries International. For more information, contact us on telephone number 041-466-4291 or email us at phanerokampala@gmail.com. You can also find us on the web at www.phanero.org. Or better still, feel free to join us every Thursday for our weekly fellowships at UMA Multipurpose Hall from 5 p.m. to 8 p.m. You can also catch the live stream at livestream.com/Phanero. Phanero, make manifest.